On this mountain top to see your kingdom come. My Redeemer, my Redeemer, my Redeemer, my Redeemer.
We're going to get started this morning. We are going to start by taking a look at our bulletins, see if there's anything new and important that we need to do. I'm just going to challenge you, please read your bulletin on your own. So we don't have to spend too much time each week doing this, but we're a couple important things that I just want to touch on. There is a baby shower coming up February 6th at 7 p.m., and that's for the two. We just recently gave stuff to the two babies, and they're listed there. And so if you want to contribute, if you want to donate to a group gift, please see Leanne or Brianne. So if Leanne or Brianne can stand up. Leanne and Brianne. There we go. So see one of them if you want to contribute. We like to get these new you know, parents something really nice. So if you can partner with that, I would encourage you to do that. A couple other things. Just remember there's Ladies Bible Study on Mondays. And then we're going to jump right up to membership candidates. It's important for us that we put this in the bulletin a couple weeks in advance, just in case somebody's like, oh, there's something going on there. I need to follow up on that. We're sure that won't happen because they are awesome people. But we're putting it in there. We're really, really excited for some of the membership candidates. We've got Wes and Deanna Unger, Mark and Chrissy Penner, and JJ. So these are the people who want to be take membership of this church, and I think that is really, really great. And then we've got this employment opportunity at the daycare. Oh, wait, is that not the one that's on here? And then we've got, let me see here, I better read that. We're hiring a student once again this summer through the Canada Summer Jobs Program. If you're interested in working with the youth in church and our community this summer, and we'll be attending a post-secondary school this fall, please contact Joanne for an application form. It is a 16-week position beginning May 9th. For any further information, please contact Adam. This is an incredible program. It's like an internship program where you guys get to work at the church. So if that's something you're interested in, just let me know. Not me, let Adam know. Not, I'll just say, okay, talk to Adam. Finally, let's go to prayer. Prayer and praise. Pray for the people who are membership candidates. Pray for the community as there are people in need. Pray that they would reach out and there are people there to respond to those needs. Pray for the Boole family from Kleefeld who lost their house to a fire. Pray also as they are still mourning the loss of their son this past November. Praise that we belong to a God who forgives our sins and loves unconditionally. And also we're going to pray. We saw there was an accident this morning. It looks like a vehicle rollover. I'm not sure who that was, but I think we need to just pray over that as well. And then we'll pray for me because I am feeling quite sick this morning. So we'll add that in there so that I can make it through. My wife says if things get really bad, I can just invite the worship team up, take off, and then come back, you know, just break up my sermon with a couple worship songs in between. So let's bring this to God. God, I want to thank you for this church. I want to thank you that the people, every week people want to be more and more involved. We are a church that's striving to change our world. I just thank you for the incredible things you did this week. I thank you for the sandwiches that were delivered to Love Lives Here. I thank you for the college and career group that's going to be making meals for those who are in need. I just thank you that we have this incredible body that loves. I pray that if there are people in this community that are in need, that they would just share their needs so that we as a church can stand up and we can show them what the love of God really looks like. I pray for the accident that we had this morning. I just pray that nobody was seriously injured and that you would just work in incredible ways there, God. And finally, I want to pray for those who are sick, including myself, that we could know your peace, God, and that we can feel better in your name. Amen. Amen. So I did not sleep very well last night. I was not feeling well. I'm feeling a little bit better now that I'm up here, but we'll see how long I can manage this morning. So I am excited. We are following up in our prayer series, Back to the Basics, Prayer. So I titled my message this morning, The Family That Prays, because this morning we are going to be talking about the importance of praying together. We're going to talk about the importance of not being alone, and there is so much more to our faith than doing it alone. But before we do that, I really, really, really felt like the message we heard last week, that wasn't necessarily my message, but the message the Holy Spirit had put on my heart, I felt like it was so incredibly important that I needed a little bit of time to review it one more time. And so we're going to review it just a little bit for those who didn't make it. And so last week we talked about, hey, maybe you're not experiencing God because you don't know how to pray to God. Maybe you're not experiencing all that God has because you just don't get how to talk to Him. And so every morning you get up with the wrong attitude, and even though you bring it to God, you bring it to God with the wrong attitude. And praying with the wrong attitude, a little bit like talking to your wife with the wrong attitude. And I pick on my wife every week, so this is the chance. If I wake up in the morning and be like, honey, where's my breakfast? She's going to be like, get your own breakfast. But if I say, hey, I love you, oh, you're so awesome, and I get up, I do my workout, and I've made the bed, and I'm just praising her for how awesome she is. She might even make me breakfast. You see how that works? When your attitude is different, the response is different. And sometimes we come to God and we're like, God, take away my anxiety. Just do it now. And then all day we're anxiously waiting for God to take away our anxiety. And it only gets worse. And so we said there is a formula in the Bible called the Lord's Prayer. And here's how it says to pray. And we're going to be really quick because I got a full other message yet. I just want to remind us. When you pray, if you really want to experience God, stop doing it in that old ritualistic way, that old traditional way. Start doing it in a new way. And so here are the six things that the Lord's Prayer talks about. Number one, worship God and give Him praise. When you get up in the morning, change your perspective. Start worshiping God. Start saying, God, you are awesome. God, we love you. Seek God's guidance for your day. Still, you're not whining about your problems. You're just saying, God, what do you want me to do today? But not just, what do you want me to do today? We already know what God wants us to do because the Bible says, love people, make a difference, change the world, forgive. So say, God, help me to do what we already know your will is today. And begin to live that way. Bring your request to God. Repent and forgive. We had a big illustration of that last week, and if you missed it, I would encourage you to go on YouTube and watch the sermon because I'm not preaching the whole thing again. But this is incredibly important. This is actually foundational to everything you should have for the rest of your life. So I would really challenge you to do that. Recognize your weakness. Seek strength and wisdom. And finally, praise God for all He has done for you and shown you. God is awesome. God is your Father. And we need to start treating Him a little bit different than we have been. We need to stop just getting up in the morning and whining to our Father. Same thing again. Not just with wives, same thing with your kids. If your kids get up in the morning, the first thing you hear is, Mommy! You're like, oh, it's going to be a long day. And so as Christians, we probably shouldn't come to our Father and be like, Daddy, life sucks. We should probably start coming and say, Dad, I love you so much. Papa, Father, you are so incredible. And as we change our attitude, as we change our perspective, as we change, if you remember the illustration with the water, as we change our concentration, we are going to experience God in a whole new way. And so I just want to challenge you over and over and over again. That is how we ought to pray. That is a very short review, but there's one more other review that I want to do. How does God communicate? For the last 2 weeks, we've been talking about how do we hear from God? How does God communicate? And we've got this problem that everybody wants to hear this great big speaker saying, you know, Heather, this is what I have for you, or whatever your name is, and this is what, and we all want that, and yet we ignore all of the other ways that God communicates. We don't listen to any of His other things, we just want the words, and I want to tell you something, you're probably not going to get the words until you're obedient in the other ways. So, how does God communicate? What does it mean to hear from God? This is our third week of talking about it, but I want to review it because it's very important for the rest of the message. God speaks today. God speaks every day. God moves every day. God does things every day, but you need to recognize what that looks like. So, how does God communicate? God communicates by giving us a new heart. Ezekiel 36, 26 to 27 says, the Holy Spirit will give you a new heart. He will change your way of thinking. So you wake up in the morning and where you used to be angry, you're not angry anymore. That was God speaking to you, changing you, communicating with you, interacting with you by giving you a brand new being. You are not the same. You are a new creation. You are born again. And so But you need to be open to experiencing that. The Holy Spirit produces fruit. That's also how he communicates. And again, we laugh because I say this every... I don't know if there's been a week in the last 3 months where I've not talked about the fruit of the Spirit. If you follow God, if you are obedient to God, if you begin to pray as we talked about last week, if you begin to live as God has asked you to live, you will experience a change in your very being. God will communicate with you. He will interact with you by changing your way of thinking. And the next thing you know, when you used to not have the capacity to love someone who's a real mean person to you, you can now love them. When you used to always be stressed when things went wrong, you can now have peace. But it all has to do with being led by the Spirit. So if you're not being led by the Spirit, if you're allowing addictions, if you're allowing sin to get in the way of the path that the Holy Spirit has set for you, you will not have love and joy and peace. So don't come to the pastor and say, hey, you're a liar. I've got no love and joy and peace. Of course you don't. You're not listening. You're not obeying. And so living according to the Spirit, walking according to the Spirit, is the only way you're going to experience love and joy and peace. 1 Corinthians 12, the Holy Spirit gives gifts. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later. And those gifts are done so that God can communicate with you. Finally, in John 16, 7 to 15, the Holy Spirit convicts us. Remember, we talked about this. The Holy Spirit gives you feelings or emotions that are not natural to you. So I'm about to do something, and I have a feeling or emotion that's not natural to me that says, don't do that. And I go, oh. You know, somebody invites me out to a party, and I'm like, oh, that sounds like fun. And all of a sudden, I used to never second-guess myself, and all of a sudden, I'm second-guessing myself. That's not you second-guessing yourself. You're not smart enough to do that. Maybe you are. I'm not smart enough to. I don't want to be mean. But I'm not smart enough to second-guess myself that often. But that is the Holy Spirit saying, be careful. Watch yourself. That is what conviction is. That's the Holy Spirit talking to you. The Holy Spirit will speak to us, and the Holy Spirit will guide us in truth. The Holy Spirit will make what sometimes is unclear in this Word of God, the Holy Spirit will bring clarity to you. That is why when we look at the Bible and the Pharisees were basically a bunch of hypocritical jerks, if you would. They were really mean. They were horrible to everybody they went to. They said, we studied the Word, but they did not know the heart of the Word. They read the letters. They didn't understand the heart. And the Holy Spirit gives us the heart of God living within us. And so it's incredibly important for that. And before we continue with the actual sermon, that's the review, we're still reviewing, I want to talk a little bit more about conviction. I want to talk a little bit more about what it means to hear God's voice. And I could probably do a full 3 messages on this, but I'm not going to. I'm just going to touch on it with some practical applications. So I've given you the scripture. I don't like to teach with just giving practical applications because I believe the Word of God can stand on its own. But sometimes a practical application is good. So I've had about 4 or 5 people talk to me this week about how God has spoken to them over the last week. And I'm going to give you one of those examples. There was a lady from church, and she was at home, and I don't know if I get the story completely right, so hopefully they don't get upset with me. But basically, there's a lady from our church, and she's unloading the groceries, and she's walking into her house, and it's slippery outside. And so going up the stairs, she falls down, and she falls down hard. And she feels like she might have actually broken her leg and hurt or her arm, and so she's sitting there going, I need to go to the hospital. I could probably get myself back into my car. I could probably get myself to the hospital, but will I be able to get home? Because if I get casted up and all, like, I'll be stuck there. Who do I call? She doesn't even know who to call. And out of the blue, a friend of hers gives her a call and says, you know what? I'd been doing some work. I'd been praying, and I was just about to go take a shower, and I thought, I should call you. So first of all, there's something important here. This is not normal. I don't normally get ready to take a shower and be like, you know what? I should probably call this person. That's not normal. It's not natural to me. It's not natural to this woman. But she said, you know what? I'm just going to do it because there's something that's drawing me to call my friend. So she calls her friend. And guess what? Her friend is in desperate need. Her friend desperately needed a phone call in that minute. And I want to tell you guys something. That's part of how God speaks. And sometimes we need to recognize that when you get a feeling inside that is not normal to you, that is not natural to you. You wouldn't naturally think this. Ask yourself, is calling this person going to be God-honoring? Maybe this is a God thing. And you know what? You're going to find out the more you listen to those feelings, the more you're going to realize that when you do them with a heart that God has for you, they will almost always be God things. Because when your focus is on God, you're going to call them for a godly purpose, and you're going to recognize that that call was important, that that visit was important, that pulling over was important. You know, and even some people say, well, that was just your gut. That was just her gut. I'm like, okay, maybe it was just her gut. Maybe the Holy Spirit doesn't speak. But I will tell you something. When we pray, our gut is accurate way more often. Yeah, that's like people saying miracles don't happen. Okay, I'm not going to argue with you. I don't want to fight about this. But I will say this. The more I pray, the better the coincidences are in my life. So whether or not, I don't know what you want to call that, but I want to tell you something. When you pray, when your heart is in the right place, when you get those feelings and you obey, you're going to find it's more often than not, it's God. And even if it's not God, if you're calling that person, if you're helping that person with the heart of God inside of you, you cannot go wrong. I had a pastor talk to me this last week or 2 weeks ago. He said, Rick, how can you, that's very dangerous to say, Rick. What if somebody says the Holy Spirit told them something and it wasn't really the Holy Spirit? What if it was their own self? And my response is always the same. If you do something for the glory of God that lines up with the Word of God, whether it was the Holy Spirit or not, I can guarantee you the Holy Spirit will work. Because the Holy Spirit either works through you or despite of you. More often than not, He works despite of me, but I love it when He works through me. But the Holy Spirit always works as long as you are faithful and doing your best, that when you have that feeling, when you have that pull in your spirit, when you have that drawing, that you obey, and pretty soon you're going to find that you're hearing God all the time, that it makes sense to you, that when you have that feeling that maybe you're like me and you don't encourage your wife enough. That's true. But maybe I don't always, and I have that feeling. I said, you know what? I should just give my wife a call and tell her that I love her. Even if that wasn't the Holy Spirit, your life will get better. Like, you don't have to even believe what I'm telling you right now, but you're going to find, you do that a couple times, you're going to realize, oh my word, I've actually heard from God. I've actually heard God speak. One more illustration, then we're going to get into the sermon. See, I'm not feeling sick at all right now. Okay, so I'm not feeling sick. This is great. I love when I get to preach and I get my sickness just disappears on me. So there's another situation just to give you a good idea. So we're in Africa, and people don't understand this. They think that missionaries get emails all the time. Like, hey guys, we're praying for you. We're there for you. You know, we miss you. That doesn't happen. When you're a missionary, you've got about three friends who contact you, you know, probably monthly. Maybe a little bit more. Not a little bit more. My wife says no, about monthly. So you get about three emails a month. And then the rest of the hundreds of people that support you just assume that you know that people are behind you. And it doesn't happen. We could literally go months without getting a single real communication from Canada. We could go months without getting a single real communication from Canada. So one night, one day, 4:30, workers come running up to us. Pindurai has slipped while cutting something on the table saw, and he's put his hand all the way through the table saw. And we go, oh my word, this is horrible. So we rush this guy to the hospital. We are stressed. We love this guy with all of our hearts. And I don't want to gross anybody out, but you're literally seeing the chips of bone coming out of his... Oh, my wife's saying, don't do that. The chips of bone coming out of his hand. There's tendons. Everything snapped. And you're just like, oh my word. Get to the hospital. The surgeon's like, okay, my nurses are all trying to get bribes from the maternity ward, so I have no nurses. And so now, here it is. I'm in the surgery. Heather's kind of praying on the side there. One of our local guys, he's doing the iodine, and I'm holding the tissue back into the finger with the little tong thingies. And the point being is that this is stressful. It's not that good. I almost passed out the one time, but we had a stressful night. We finally get this guy sewed up with a single surgeon, no nurses available. We get him home, and we are stressed. Next morning, we get a call from the judge that we're trying to adopt Ryan from, and the judge says, I need to see you in my office. So the next morning, we are stressed. We're like, I hope our friend isn't going to be permanently disabled. So we're stressed. We get to the place, and this judge, we didn't realize, was going through some personal conflict in his life. And so he was in a very bad mood, and he calls into the office, and he had told us a couple months earlier that we could take Ryan into our home before the adoption happened. He apparently forgot that and basically, in a very short conversation, accused us of kidnapping our own child without the judge's permission, and there was a very good chance that he was going to reject our application for adoption and take away Ryan. And so now we've had like this incredibly stressful 2 days, and we're walking out of there, and Heather is like right in public. She's basically bawling. She is broken. And as we walk down, we are walking down the stairs from the courthouse, and we think we might not get to adopt our little boy who's already lived with us for a couple months, and Heather gets a beep on her phone. And it's an email. an email from somebody she's met for all of 10 minutes? 5 minutes in her entire life. She's known this woman for 5 minutes. And that was like 3 years earlier. But that woman said she was going to pray for us. And all of a sudden, something out of the ordinary, this woman woke up in the morning and felt, I should email Heather. She didn't know if that was the Holy Spirit, but she said, this is not normal. And it's God-honoring, and so I'm going to follow it. And so she goes and she emails Heather. And in our deepest, darkest moment, in our time in Africa, there was not a whole lot of times where we were more stressed than almost losing a hand of a friend, at the same time almost having our child taken out of our home. And we were broken. And this woman says, you know what? I feel like God told me to give you an email. Say, hey, keep up the work. Endure. And everything that she talked about was exactly what we were going through. I want to tell you something. That only happens when you don't wake up in the morning and say, boo-hoo, boo-hoo, boo-hoo. You wake up in the morning and say, God, you are awesome. You wake up in the morning and say, "What? I know your will for me is to encourage other people. Who should I encourage?" And when that name that you would not normally think of jumps into your mind, obey it. And send them an email. Call them up. Take someone out for coffee. And that, I just wanted to clarify, because some people wanted some clarity last week. They asked me, what does that really mean by conviction? And those are two stories, kind of pushing it home to you that the Holy Spirit speaks. And so now we're going to get into the message. The message is a bit shorter, so it's okay. The review is longer than the message, I think, this morning. Anyway, so I want to continue. So last week we talked about the Lord's Prayer. Last week we said that if you want to hear from God, change the way you pray. Stop looking at yourself and start looking outward. But that's only one example of prayer. And so this morning I'm going to make an incredibly bold statement that many of you will not want to hear about prayer. And that is this. You will never fully experience all God has choosing to be alone. You will never fully hear the voice of God if you try and do it all on your own. I'm going to tell you, I believe it's biblical, that that is not possible. You will never fully experience the power of God in your life if you always try and do it on your own. You were designed by God for community. You were born with a longing for your mother. You grew up where you would disobey your parents just to fit in with a bunch of punk kids at school. Then you get older and all you desire with all your being is to have a couple close friends and to find that special someone. And you find that special someone and all you want is to raise a family together. You see, God designed you in His image, and in His image is community, is the desire for love, is the desire for a relationship. And God wants you to love Him like that and to love everyone else like that. I looked at this week. It said, designed this way on purpose. When you were born longing for love. You were designed that way on purpose. When you were born, you had a desire for family because you were designed this way on purpose. And then you got saved. And you said, no, this is just between me and God. That's exactly, it always goes that way. People go, they get saved, they're pumped, and they're like, okay, I don't need anybody else in my life. It's between me and God. Everyone else can just butt out. And I want to tell you something. The Bible says, not me, not your pastor, the Bible says that you will not fully experience the working of the Holy Spirit in your life if you do not do it in community. And I believe I can say that with complete and utter confidence, because we're going to take a look at what the Bible says about the importance of praying with your Christian family. The importance of studying the Word with your Christian family. I believe it is so biblical that I can say that with confidence that you will not fully experience God on your own. I want to give you an example, another little story, just a fictional kind of thing. I want you to imagine it's a little bit like this. You love basketball. I don't know anybody that loves basketball. I'm not a really big basketball fan, but let's say you love basketball for some reason. And so you love basketball, and somebody comes up to you, and you get approached by this incredible coach, and he says, hey, I want to recruit you to be on my team. And he's like, here's how it works. Every week you get 20 minutes one-on-one time. Just me and you. We're just going to work. I'm going to teach you some of the things that I know. And then we're going to have practice with everybody else to prepare you for the game. And finally, we're going to have a game. Now, Christians are a lot like that guy who's been invited onto the team. They say, that's awesome. I would love some one-on-one time with the coach. I would love some one-on-one time with God. So we say, yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. But I want to tell you something. Imagine that player getting invited onto that team, and every time it's time to practice as a group, they say, forget you. We're not interested. I don't want to be part of the team. Do you know what? There's a lot of things that you don't understand that the other people on the team maybe understand. And if you don't learn what it means to be part of a team, you will never be an all-star. No matter how good your one-on-one time with the coach is, you can never be an all-star. You will never fully experience the enjoyment of basketball, if there is such a thing. You will never experience that joy of basketball. I'm not a basketball guy, sorry. You will never experience that joy of basketball until you start learning as a team. You start coming together as a team because there's times where one person understands something that you don't. And so they teach you. It's pretty hard to learn how to do a kind of a two-on-one system. If there's only two of you, you need that extra one to do the system. You can't learn how to defend yourself. You can't learn how to do stuff if you don't have the whole scenario in front of you. And so as Christians, we were called to make a difference. And if we don't get together as groups, whether it be care groups, whether it be Bible studies, whether it be prayer groups, whether it be praying together here, if you do not do that, how in the world can you confidently say, I'm experiencing all that God has for me? Because God called you to be part of family. You were adopted into a family. As a matter of fact, before you became a Christian, you were alone. God created you to feel alone, even in a group, when you were not a Christian. Because there was one thing that makes a family complete, and that is the Father. And when you became part of the family, you went from being alone to being in community. I'm going to read something for you this morning. Spiritual gifts were given as communication with us. Very clearly in the Bible, spiritual gifts were given to keep, so God could communicate with you. So if you want to fully get God's communication, if you want to fully hear from God, listen to these verses. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by the means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All of these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and He distributes them to each one just as He determines. So I want to do that. Now we're going to take a closer look at what I just read there. A closer look. To some, for the common good. You have to remember, for the common good. If you are not getting together with other people, you can't be part of the common good. It's like saying for the team, but you're not being part of the team. So if the coach teaches the team for the common good, and you're like, forget that, you will never fully experience. So what's the Holy Spirit going to do? How's the Holy Spirit going to speak? Message of wisdom. The Holy Spirit speaking wisdom through one person for the benefit of many. So God has a word. It's a word for these people. But that person over there decides they don't want to be here. They cannot fully experience that word from God because they are hiding at home. It's not possible. The word was given for the common good, but you weren't part of the common group, and therefore you did not experience all that God has for you. It's clear. Okay? Message of knowledge. The Holy Spirit revealing truth to somebody that they could not know on their own for the building up of another. So the Holy Spirit actually speaks to you. You can actually hear. You want to hear the voice of God audibly? Here's what it is. The Holy Spirit tells somebody something, and they come up to you, and they say, okay, Ernie, here's the word. Here's something that the Holy Spirit has put on my heart. You actually get to hear God speak through somebody else. Do you know how hard that is to do when you're all by yourself? Do you know how hard it is to hear somebody give you a word from God when you don't want to hang out with anybody? And I get it. We're a bunch of hypocrites here. But even still, you still won't. If you can't forgive the hypocrites, if you can't say, okay, I'm going to forgive the people who aren't quite there, you're never going to fully experience God because you will always find hypocrites. But God still uses broken and busted people like me. And if God's going to use a broken and busted hypocritical person like me, you got to say, oh, my word, He's going to use you as well. And so sometimes it's the same hypocrites that we get angry with who also every now and again get a word. And so it's pretty important. Let me get back. Prophecy, ability to speak or declare God's truth to others. So if God speaks through prophecy, if God speaks through wisdom, if God speaks through words of knowledge, but you're not willing to get together with other Christians to celebrate the work of God, you cannot, in quite clarity, you cannot experience all that God has for you. And so let's stop doing that. Let's stop being Sunday morning Christians. That's the whole point of this message this morning. Everybody wants to hear from God. We just want everybody else to butt out. We're tired of other people giving us their opinions. We're tired of other people helping us. We're tired of what we feel like judgment. If you feel judged, maybe it's because you're judging yourself. Maybe it's because you're seeing in somebody else, what you already felt in yourself. And okay, here's the reality. Yeah, some of us can be judgy. I can be judgy sometimes. I get that. But guess what? You're stronger than my judgment. You're stronger than when I'm being judgy. You're stronger than all that stuff because I am broken too. And we need to learn to forgive each other. We talked about that last week. Forgive each other and help each other not be so judgy and then get together. But that's not going to happen if the moment you see me make a mistake, you run away. How am I going to get better as a believer if somebody doesn't say, Rick, that was really stupid? Look, I always think I'm right. Like, if I didn't think I was right, I wouldn't say all that stuff. So I need somebody to call me on it when I get too judgy or if I become too hypocritical. Instead of running away because I'm a hypocrite, come and let me know. I can't get better if you don't tell me. That's the way it works. God wanted us to do that. 5 reasons family is important. And I'm talking about church family. Number 1, encouragement. A friend may get a word from God and speak it to you as encouragement. God can speak through our friends. They push us to be better. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. I sometimes fail. I sometimes need a kick in the butt. Encouragement can even be a kick in the butt. I'm going to encourage you to get off your butt. I'm going to encourage you to do something. Or maybe encouragement is, you know what? I really feel like you are an incredible leader. Imagine that. Imagine God wanting to let you know that you have a capacity to do something great, but you're having a hard time hearing from God. And so God gives that word to somebody who's hearing. And that person comes up to you and says, hey, you know what? I really feel like you're an incredible godly leader. That's a word from God through your friend. It is a word of encouragement through your friend. And again, you cannot experience that as a hermit. All right, accountability. Our friends keep us accountable and help us to continue to walk according to the Holy Spirit so we can hear more from God. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. And when we are led by the Spirit, you do not get those incredible supernatural gifts if you're not led by the Spirit. I think that's fair enough to say. But sometimes I plug my ears. Sometimes I am a hypocrite. Sometimes I am judgy. Sometimes I am not living like God wants me to live. And sometimes I need somebody to come up to me and say, the way you are living is against what God wants. And I should actually want that. Who doesn't want love? Who doesn't want joy? Who doesn't want peace when everything goes wrong? You know, when we were going through this thing with Ryan, our friend almost loses his fingers. We could not do it if it was not for the peace of God. And we got that peace, number one, through encouragement, through an email. We got it, number two, because we were walking according to the Spirit. Because when we got out of track, when I began to have sin in my life, even the smallest sins, there was always our director or other Christian missionary friends who'd be like, hey, Rick, I'd shape up if I were you. If I came across being too judgy, I can trust him to come and be like, Rick, that was really, really hypocritical of you. My goal in life is to not be a hypocrite. My goal in life, I desperately desire to be intimate with God. I desperately desire love and joy and peace. And I get it. If I start not living that life, if I start living hypocritically, I'm not walking according to the Spirit. The only way for me to fix that is if I get a lot smarter than I am right now, or if I have friends who keep me accountable. And so if I want to live according to the Spirit, I desperately, desperately want my friends to help me to be better, to keep me accountable. James 5:16, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. Confess your sins one to another. This is not me going, oh, I'm going to pick on Tim again. Tim, I'm so sorry for what I did to you. No. That might be part of it, but maybe part of it is saying, Tim, I'm struggling with something. I need help. I can't do it on my own. And then Tim and me pray about it. We say, God, help Rick to have the courage to forgive. You know what happens? On Wednesday, Tim says, "Hey, Rick, how's that forgiveness going?" "Oh, I was just about to get bitter. But now I've been reminded of the commitment that I made." You need to have the people in your life that you love enough that you can trust to bring your struggles to, who won't judge you, who won't be hypocritical, who won't be mean to you, who will say, "Man, I see greatness in you. I see you doing incredible things for God," and encouraging you and keeping you accountable. Ecclesiastes 4, 9, and 10. "Two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up." It's a great principle. It's not necessarily talking about sin, but it would work there too. When I fall down, I have someone to say, "Rick, shape up." Because the reality is, if you're not my friend, I probably don't want you to tell me to shape up. If I don't know you, I don't want you correcting me. That's why we do as Christians? We try to not know anybody. So that we can feel superior when somebody corrects us. That we can feel like, "Yeah, you judgy little Christian." But what if you had a group of friends? What if you had people that you actually allowed to correct you? That you actually allowed to make you better? Do you know what? You would be better. You'd be a better parent. You'd be a better husband or a better wife. You'd be a better person all around because you allowed somebody to speak into your life. And that's what God has called us to do. I just want to make a quick note here because I love the study of the Word. And there was a verse that I immediately was going to use, and I realized that I had taken it out of context, but I'm going to share it anyways. Matthew 18, 15 to 20. This is a verse you've all heard about 100 times. "Where two or more are gathered in my name, therefore am I. And anything you ask will be given you, and what you bind on earth will be bound in heaven." You know that verse? The verse that kind of implies that we can twist God's arm if we get enough people together. You know the one? "Two or more gathered, there I am, wherever you're." And we're like, yeah. I'm going to go with my buddies. We're going to twist God's arm. You know what's incredible about that verse? You know what that verse is really talking about? That verse isn't talking about twisting God's arm. That verse is talking about accountability. That is a verse about discipline. That is actually a verse about church discipline. Because you know what? Jesus knew that not every issue of today is written in the New Testament. There are some areas that when our culture changes, it's pretty hard to know what God wants. We're like, okay, now what does God think about this? Or what does God think about this? And so God said, here's the deal. I'm going to speak to many people. And in those difficult situations, I am going to speak to many people. So if there is somebody doing something, and the elders of the church or many people pray together, and they all are convicted, they're all drawn to the fact that this is not right, they can with confidence come before everybody and bind that thing. Say, that lifestyle is unacceptable. That verse is about accountability. That verse is about the Holy Spirit speaking the same word to many people. That is an incredible verse, not about twisting God's arm, what about God twisting ours? About God saying, "Hey guys, I know it's not super clear. Bible doesn't really talk a whole lot about drugs. Bible doesn't really talk a whole lot about drugs. And yet, as we come together and as we pray, and the Holy Spirit says, 'Rick, that's wrong.' And then Dave's like, 'You're right, Rick. The Holy Spirit told me that.' And Justin says, 'Yeah, the Holy Spirit.' Then where two or more are gathered in my name, we can ask it of God. And he will tell us the truth. He will guide us and he will direct us." That whole passage is about accountability. And I'm not saying it's not true to other things. I'm not saying, well, that now write it off for everything else. But in context, it's actually about accountability. And it's so cool that God wants to speak to everybody together. And you know what? That verse is completely and utterly useless, no matter how you read it. Even if you say, "Rick, I think you're wrong. It's about twisting God's arm." That's fine. It still doesn't work if you do it by yourself. It still doesn't work if you do it by yourself. Because the heart of God is that we live in relationship with one another. That church is not this. This is not church. Church is every day. Church is all week long. Church is a gathering of people and then finally coming together. Understanding. We hear from God through the Word. As we study the Word together, we can help one another grow in their understanding of the Word and in turn hear God better. This, my friends, is the voice of God. He speaks through His Spirit. We talked about that convicting, that drawing, that pulling. But He also speaks through this incredible book. But not all of us are super good at reading it. Not all of us have the same understanding. Not all of us really understand how it works. And so we go home and we do the old, "Holy Spirit, give me wisdom." Okay, there we go. And it means nothing. We do it again. Okay, we go, "Okay, now let's flip it here. okay, and thou shalt not cut your flesh for the dead. And I'm like, what does that mean? But as we learn to study the Word of God, no, it's true. As we learn to study the Word, you can't do it on your own. And you cannot let Google do it for you. Because all Google does is it finds enough people who agree with you. Even if you have a stupid idea, they find enough people to agree with you. And you're like, see, the Bible says. No, you need to get together with people, actual real life human beings who can talk to you and you can work your way through this. And it's something we don't do anymore as a church. It's something that we've stopped doing like we used to do, where we would get together and say, what does the Bible say about this? I love being a youth pastor. Because when I was a youth pastor, it was so easy. I said, what do you guys want to learn about? And they're like, okay, Rick, what's the Bible say about tattoos? Because, of course, every young person wants to get tattoos. And so we'd sit and we'd study it. What does the Bible say? And we'd learn and we'd study. We'd look into it and we'd go, okay, there we go. And we'd come up with an answer. And they would not be able to do that all by themselves. They needed help. What does the Bible say about getting freedom from addictions? And you're like, I don't know. I don't know. Well, guess what? There's people who've read it. There's people who understand it. You will not fully understand it if you're not fully engaging with other men and women of faith. Proverbs 27:17. As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. You want to get sharp? You want to get sharp, you got to do it with somebody else. You know what? Trying to just take Kev likes his knives. If Kev were to take one of his swords, he likes these steel swords, right? You got a couple steel swords. If you were to take a steel sword and just go outside and just start waving it, he's like, sharpen, sharpen, sharpen. You know what? He would just look really silly. I mean, he really looks really silly when he does all the sword stuff anyways. But this would be especially silly. I see Brianna's kind of going, yeah, that's right. Okay. But you know what? When you want to sharpen that, you got to sharpen it on something else that's sharp. You got to sharpen on something that's hard. You can't just sharpen it on air. You can't just live your faith all by yourself and just hope it's going to work out. You're not going to get sharp because you're going to be banging things. You're going to be hitting things in your life, and you're going to get dull, but you won't have anybody to make you sharp again. It's like using that sword but never sharpening it. It does not work. You need other people or you will not fully experience what God has. He said it over and over and over. Obedience. Worshiping together, praying together, gathering together for the study of the Word and prayer is part of obedience. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Not let him pray, not let her pray, let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. We did that this morning. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. We have been called to pray together. We have been called to pray together. You know, we've got this idea, and I'm going to nail it a couple times here yet. We've got this idea in our head that our faith is purely personal. That our relationship with God is purely personal. But that's like saying Ryan's relationship is purely personal with us. No, he's got a relationship as a family. We are a family. He's got Tendai, he's got mom, he's got dad. We are a family, and you will not be fully experiencing what the family has if you do not join in. Imagine the family went to Disney World and we left Ryan behind. He would not be happy. Imagine your parents went to Disney World and they brought your brothers and sisters, but they left you behind. Do you think you would have the same memories? Do you think you'd have the same story when you got old? Do you think you'd even have the same love for your parents when you got old if every time they went on a trip, they left you behind? No, but as Christians, we're like, God, I want to experience you, just not with these yahoos. No, and I get that. I've been on road trips with my brothers. I've done this. I get it. There's times where you're like, I don't want it with these yahoos. But you know what? Even when we did those things, we'd go hunting in the ducks, and I'd be like, oh, brother. Literally, oh, brother, you know. We'd be out hunting, you know. Oh, but some of the best experiences we ever had. Yeah, they'd get on my nerves because I'm always right and they're always wrong, and it's pretty hard to deal with. They'd get on my nerves at times, but I want to tell you something. The greatest experiences in my entire life, the best memories I have ever made in my entire life have been surrounded by people that I love. I can imagine almost no life-changing, huge, impactful memories that happened just when I was all by myself. You know, like you know, you guys heard the story where I fought the crocodile. I love that. But it wouldn't have been nearly as cool if I was trying to do it by myself. I kind of liked having like people that we could be like, yeah, we just killed this crocodile. It's so much cooler when you've got people around you, right? You know, you've just been like, yeah, we just did this. When you go do anything you do, it's so much fun when you do it with other people. And so that's part of what God wants. And finally, this morning I want to say affirmation. God can use people in our lives to affirm what we already believe the Holy Spirit is saying to us. Brings truth to others. That's part of the fruit of the gift of the Spirit, that knowledge and that wisdom and that prophecy. You know, when Dad died, that really sucked. And I've told you guys this many times. I'm not ashamed to say this. I did not want to come back. You guys are awesome. I'm sure you're all the greatest people on earth. But I really love Africa. It was so incredibly awesome. And I'll tell you now, I don't want to go back. I mean, I want to go back to visit, but I love you guys now. Like, I love you guys now. Now I love you guys. But I want to tell you something. I began to feel almost right after Dad died, because me and Dad, and I haven't told this all with you guys, but me and Dad would talk a lot about the church. Even when he was alive, we would talk. And I'd say, hey, Dad, this is a vision. He'd say, Rick, I love your passion for abundant life. I love your vision. And we would actually have conversations about the vision of the church for the future. We would do this together. I'd be like, Dad, we should do more mentoring. Or Dad would be like, yeah, but what about evangelism? We, you know, we would have these conversations because Dad was the evangelist. I'm a disciple, or we're a little bit different. And we would go back and forth. And when Dad died, I was like, God kept giving me these words for the church. I'm like, this doesn't make sense. I thought I was just here to help Dad. I genuinely believe that the Holy Spirit was speaking to me to help my dad. And the Holy Spirit said, no, I want you to go back. And that was tough for me. But you know what I did? I began to pray, and I began to find people that I felt like always seemed to know what God wanted. They always seemed to have a word of knowledge from God. And a lot of people said, Rick, you should come back. But most of them were just in grief. I was like, oh, thank you. But I didn't necessarily take it as a word from God, because they were just in grief. They wanted somebody who was like Dad. But you know what I did? I found people, not even from this church, who I believe had the gift of knowledge. And I called these guys up. I didn't even tell them the whole story. I said, I got a prayer request for you. I'm struggling with something. Where should I go in life? I'm going to call you back in 3 weeks. I want you to pray about it for 3 weeks. You know what happened in 3 weeks? I called those three or four guys, and every single one, without even having the whole story, they all said, we feel... And I already knew what the Holy Spirit, I was like Jonah. I'm like, I'm not going. You guys are Nineveh, and I'm not going to them. I am not going to Nineveh. I mean, I realize I might have been wrong, but I'm not going to Nineveh. You know, I'm not going to those guys. And so, I knew God was saying, go. And I'm like, God, no, I need. And all three guys said the same thing to me. They said, you know what to do in your spirit. They didn't even give me a yes or no. They said, you know what to do. You know you're supposed to go. They didn't know I was even... I didn't even actually tell them that I was talking about abundant life. All they said, they didn't know if I meant go to Angola. They didn't know if I meant go to Asia. All they said is, you know you should go. And it wasn't exactly like that. It was kind of that's kind of sort of how it worked out in my remembrance of it. But the point of it is this. I needed people. I desperately, desperately needed people to affirm something in me. To affirm that I was hearing the Holy Spirit. As a matter of fact, just two or 3 weeks ago, Same sort of thing. I'm here praying. And sometimes you guys will find that if you stop praying the way God wants you to pray, you start just looking at yourself, God seems to be far away. You're like, where's God? Like, I don't feel that. I was sitting here praying, and I kind of gotten a little bit mopey, lost my focus a little bit. And I said, God, just affirm for me again that you are alive and that you speak. And I knew he was alive and he spoke. It's not that I was doubting that, but it was just that, you know, that feeling I need a little. And as I said amen, I was right here. As I said amen, somebody from our church walked up to me. And said, you know what, I feel like God wants me to pray for you. And I'm like, what? What? I literally, less than 5 seconds earlier, asked God for someone to come pray for me. And this guy walks up to me and says, can I pray for you? You know, God affirms over and over and over in your life that he is real. God is there to affirm in you that he loves you, that he cares for you, that you are something incredible. But how in the world are you going to get that true and solid affirmation all by yourself? And I'll tell you something, in a big group like this of 200 people, it is hard to get it. I'll be honest, it is hard to get it, because you show up, you got about 5 minutes out there, and then you come in here, and we sing. There's not a lot of time to interact. You listen to some long-winded preacher go on and on and on, and then by that time you're just waking up, and it's back to singing. And then it's back to singing, and then we leave. But you know what? as a church, we believe, and this is part of our vision of a church, is we believe that God is going to do miracles in Gruntzel. We believe that Gruntzel 100% for God isn't just his wild, outlandish dream, but we also recognize that it will not happen if we do not hear from God as a church. And as a church, we cannot fully hear from God. Biblically, the Bible says you cannot fully hear from God when you try and go it on your own. This relationship with God is not just personal. Yes, he will speak to you personally. He will guide you personally. He will direct you personally. But that is a portion of your walk with God. There is a much bigger portion where he uses other people. He lifts you up through other people. Every one of the disciples did it in a team. Everybody, you look at all the disciples, they always needed that word of affirmation. They always needed that accountability. They always needed somebody to lift them up, to speak life into them. And then we come to church, and we're in this modern day church, and we go, bah, humbug. I don't want to do small groups. I get it. I'm not blind. I get that we see people in the church, and we go, I don't want to hang out with them because I see how they act sometimes. I get that. But then let's get together with the people we do like. I'm not saying you have to get together with everybody. I'm saying get together with people you do like. Find the people you do like. Get together and grow each other. Help each other. Lift each other up. Pray for each other. Encourage one another. Because if you're not doing it, you are not fully experiencing God. And I know there's probably people here this morning going, uh-oh. I'm not really doing a whole lot during the week. It's fine. I'm not saying you're not hearing from God. I'm just saying you're not fully hearing from God. But I want to encourage you, do something. And it doesn't have to be super organized. It doesn't have to be okay. I'm not trying to grow any church programs here, guys. I'm not a program person. I want to grow people. I want to have people who show up and they're like, yes, life is awesome. I haven't dealt with depression in 6 months because my eyes have moved to Jesus. And I have people lifting me up. I have people encouraging me. I have people praying for me. Or somebody says, you know what? I'm actually going to sell everything I have and go to Africa. You can do that too because maybe that'll happen. Maybe you'll find yourself going and working at Love Lives here every single Thursday because you got three friends who they all want to make a difference. And you finally say, you know what, we're going to do this. And you're going to hear God speak to you. And you're going to see God work in you. And you're going to see people get saved. And as you see people get saved, as you see people get fed, as you see people get helped, do you know what's going to happen? You're going to recognize 6 months from now that you were not the same person then that you are now. And it's going to become so crystal clear to you. The Holy Spirit speaks by altering your very being when you do it as a family. So I want to challenge you. I'm going to invite the worship team up. Look at that, a short message this morning. I am early. Woo! I want to encourage you guys this morning. As we pray this morning, go and encourage somebody. We did it at Christmas and I thought it went really well. But if you're praying and you just feel like God is pulling you to pray for somebody, his name just jumps into your mind. You're just like, oh, I should. I know that feeling. I stand up here sometimes and like, you might see me doing this. Sometimes that's just me fighting with God, you know. God's pushing and I'm pulling. God's pushing. I'm like, I should go pray with him. It's not me exercising. It's not me getting all fidgety. It's me being disobedient. Not always, so don't just think I'm always being disobedient up front. But sometimes it's me fighting with God. Because when we pray and we have that feeling like I should go pray with this person, and you don't do it, that person is missing out. You are robbing that person of a word from God because God gave you the word to pray. And now you're robbing them of hearing from God. And so when we're praying together, when we're worshiping together, when we're singing together, it's not all about, I encourage you to come to the front. I encourage you to come for prayer. I encourage you to bring it to this team. But I encourage you almost more so to find people around you who you go, man, I want to pray with this guy. This guy's so encouraging. Look what this guy has been through. You're going to be an incredible leader for Christ. And that person's going to go through this thing, oh my word, the Holy Spirit spoke to me today through Bob or through Fred or through John or through whoever. The Holy Spirit spoke to me today through somebody else because that's how the Holy Spirit often speaks. That's why all the gifts of the Spirit are about family. That's why so much stuff in the Bible is about doing it together. You are not on your own. If you've got sin to confess, you can do it up here. You can tell me, that's fine. But I would encourage you to find somebody who's going to keep you accountable. You know, I think you come to me because you know the pastor doesn't have time to help keep everyone accountable. You know what? Go to somebody who'll keep you accountable. Go to somebody who'll say, hey, what's your internet usage look like this week? Hey, Have you encouraged your wife this week? Start praying as couples with other couples. Start finding a couple that you can pray with and say, you know what, our marriage is struggling. Can we pray about it? You can bring it to me and I'll pray. I believe there's power in that. But how much cooler is it when you've got a friend that you love who can take you guys out on a date night? Who can lift you up? Who can encourage you? When you've got a sin, who can help you avoid it? When you've got anxiety, who can help you live a life of freedom by working out with you? Me and Devin, we're working out. You know, if I'm going through a hard time, I'm going to talk to Devin about those things. Why? Because I know he can help me with some of the things that I need help with. Or I talk to Heather about some things because I know Heather can help me with those things. And I pray with her, and as she recognizes those things, she makes me better through the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is alive and well. The Holy Spirit is moving. Pray with somebody today. Find somebody to lift up. Pray with your parents. Pray with your kids. Pray with your friends. Pray with somebody today and say, I want to be part of something bigger. And I want to, just in closing, real quick, I'm excited. Coming February, just as a side note, coming February, we're going to start doing some training, just a single night of training for people who want to start getting together with their friends. We're going to call it care group training, but it could just be you want to get together with three friends. We're going to have a meeting. We're going to get sit down. I'm going to tell you, show you how you can really start to get into the Word. I'm going to tell you what it looks like to have a family of Christians that prays together. We're going to start doing that in small groups, guys. And I believe that this church is going to pack out. I believe that in just a very short amount of time, we're not going to know what to do with ourselves. Because we're not going to be hypocrites anymore, and people are going to start coming in more often. We're not going to be as judging. People are going to start coming in. People are going to see the light in our lives on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. They're going to see the integrity in us because our buddies told us to shape up. But that happens through these group times. That happens through worshiping all week long. And I am so grateful to be part of such an incredible family that is hearing God today. If you want to hear God this morning, guys, pray. Pray. And not just by yourself. Think about someone to pray with and speak the Holy Spirit's truth to them. God, you are awesome. God, you are so special. You are so incredible. I thank you for the people who have given me your truth when I could not hear it on my own. God, I thank you that when I was in a dark time in my life, that you sent somebody to speak to me when my ears were plugged. That some actual real life person kind of pulled my fingers out of my ears and said, God has a word for you. Now shape up and listen to it. I just thank you for how incredible you are, God. And I pray that this morning that you speak to people, both in their convictions, in their hearts, and through the mouths of their friends, God. I pray that we be a church that prays. You are so awesome. You are so holy, God. We love you. Amen.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide. You know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are.